them as being born again or not, every person created carries within them a seed of greatness. Every person carries within them a business. Somebody says, I'm a child of God. Do you understand what that means to be a child of God? Because the first picture God gives us is that of a creator. Who are the people right now whom we call truly successful? People who have created. So, Christians love to pray, love to be in church, love to become spiritual. Instead of using, do you know that a Christian was supposed to be the most powerful being? Because what you call prayer brings you at the platform where you can dialogue with God. Work is given to you because you are highly skilled. And when you don't have skill, people don't give you work. So when you hear people saying, oh, there are no jobs, no one is hiring, what they're actually telling you to say, I am skillless, I have no ability, I have not developed myself, I have nothing, I just went to school. And
welcome to Wisdom 101. Welcome, viewers, to Wisdom 101 with me, Pastor Owezi Manasseh. We are going to have a one-on-one with Wisdom on Wisdom for Wealth. And I want you to stay back, be relaxed, and if you've got a pen, you've got a diary, you've got a notepad, you've got something that you can take some things down, I would love you to have something near you, because the things we are going to go into are going to open you up to a lot of things concerning wisdom for wealth. Now, wisdom, I love giving the definition of wisdom as wisdom being the way of seeing. Meaning wisdom is the lens that you use to see life through. Wisdom is the lens that you use to interpret things. Wisdom is the lens that you use to judge. Wisdom is the lens that you use to see things. And I keep saying wisdom is a way of seeing. The way you see people, the way you see value, the way you see difference, the way you see everything that you see. Wisdom is a way of seeing. The way you see life. So there are a lot of things that we see, and we see them in a certain way because of the lens that we use. Every person has got a lens, and that lens has been developed over the years. A lot of things contribute to a person's lens. How they perceive life and how they see life. And it might be upbringing, it might be educational background, it might be exposure, but listen to the definition of wisdom. Wisdom is a way of seeing things, way of seeing life, way of seeing difference, way of seeing value. So the wisdom book is the Bible. I keep telling people to say the Bible is not a religious book. This is a wisdom book, because God is the one that inspired every writer who wrote to write what they wrote. So the Bible is a wisdom book, and anyone who wants to become very wise will go into this book to really get the wisdom. But it's not just a wisdom book, it's also, to me, a wealth manual. It's also a success handbook, meaning it's a wisdom book. It's a book on how to become wealthy. It's a book on how to become successful. To me, it's a leadership book. When I say it's a wisdom book, I mean everything you need to know about life is hidden in this book. So don't look at the Bible as a religious book. And for Wisdom for Wealth, I will use this book. And especially from the wealthiest man of his time. I always tell people, whatever you want to become, study it. It's funny that in life, we study to become accountants, and we become accountants. We study to become teachers, and we become teachers. We study to become economists, and we become economists. But people do not want to study wisdom. They do not want to go into the wisdom of God so as to become wise. If you want wisdom, you go into the Bible, and it will open you up to uncommon wisdom. Then if you want to study wealth, in the same Bible, there are people who are very wealthy. So You can study people like Job. Job was the greatest man in the East when you read the book of Job. You can study people like Abraham. Abraham was one of the richest men of his time. You can study people like Isaac. Imagine Isaac was so big that a nation had to come and make a treaty with him. That's how big he was. You can study Jacob. Jacob, who later on the name was changed to Israel, became so big, and a city could not hold him and his brother. They could not live in one city, two of them, because of the amount of wealth that they had, the animals that they had, the properties that they had. So you'll find that the Bible is not a religious book. This is a book that has got many things hidden in it. And the wealthiest people of their time are recorded in this book. So when you study a man like Solomon, up to today, I don't think anyone has ever hit the wealth that Solomon hit, because Solomon was the wealthiest man. Look, study history. He wasn't just the wealthiest Jew. In his days, it is still known and acknowledged by scholars everywhere that the man was so wealthy. So if you want to study wealth, you study the wealthy people in the Bible. David was also a very wealthy man. But for this one, we'll look a little bit about Solomon. Solomon was one of the wealthiest men, and he wrote a book, Proverbs. That's where most of the wisdom that he had was hidden. And I want to open something in Proverbs chapter 8. Every time I teach, I love to read Proverbs chapter 8, verse 10 and verse 11, because to me these are foundational scriptures. It says in Proverbs 8, verse 10, "Choose my instruction instead of silver, knowledge rather than choice gold." Verse 11, "For wisdom is more precious than rubies, and nothing you desire can compare with her." Listen to that. Choose instruction instead of silver, knowledge rather than choice gold. Then it goes on to say, "For wisdom is more precious than rubies, and nothing you desire can compare with her." Why does wisdom become priority? Why is wisdom pushed to be more important than rubies? Why is instruction, knowledge, why are these things put ahead of silver and gold? A lot of people think what they need is money. If you talk to an average person, say, "What do you want? Do you want to become wealthy?" I've never asked that question. Do you want to become wealthy? Do you want to become successful? Do you want to become prosperous? And people don't lift up their hands. Everywhere you go, people want to become wealthy. They want to become successful. They want to become rich. They want it. But guess what? Just wishing for something does not make it become a reality. A lot of people wish they were wealthy. A lot of people wish they were successful. But the scripture we read, it says choose. Meaning life is not about wishing. Life is not about hoping one day something will happen. Or one day, you hear people say, "One day, if God is there, one day he will do something also for me." I think you wait forever. Because in reality, that one day never comes. Because the way reality is, the only thing you ever have in life is your day. You don't have tomorrow. You don't have yesterday. The only thing you ever have in life is today. Meaning, if I don't take today and make the most out of today, if I don't take today and make it a success, if I do not start moving on the path to become rich and to become wealthy, to hit financial freedom today, if I do nothing with my day today, there is no way I can become wealthy one day. And that's why you find that the wealthiest, the most successful people create daily routines. What you see them do every day is taking them to their ultimate goal. If you want to become wealthy, we must see it today in your day. We must see it in your study. We must see it in your time investment. By the way, you see people and where they're going to end up on how they use their time. Think about this. You will never find a poor person who values time. And if you notice, I'm pausing when I say this, because I want that to hit you. I wanted to open you to something. You will never find a poor person who values time. Whether it's in the office, whether it's in church, whether it's in community, whether it's in society, study every poor person. You will never find one who values time. Why? They are already poor in their attitude towards time. They are already poor in their understanding of time. If I see the way you use time, I can tell you your financial future. By just the way you use time. People around me always tell me to say, why are you so cautious of time? My life is what I've traded my time for. All of us, if you look at what we end up being as in life, it will be what we would have traded our time for. Meaning your success, your wealth, your riches, your prosperity is tied to time. And what you do with time is very important. For you to move from where you are to where you need to be, you need to maximize time. And don't forget the statement that I said, you will never find a poor person who values time. An average poor person does this with time. They want to spend it. You hear statements like, I want to go and see my brother so that I just spend some time. Some people, you hear them say things like, I want to kill some time. The time you kill and the time you spend, you don't get back. The time that you lose, you don't get back. Time does not stop. No one can store time, neither can anyone save time. You can either use it wisely or you can waste it. There's no one who can preserve time. You're either going to use it wisely, you're either going to invest it, or you're going to spend it or waste it. But listen, you've heard this statement maybe. Some people say, time is money. What do they mean? Time is money. The time you have is what you use to produce money. The time you have is what you use to produce. It can either be services, it can either be products, it can either be a solution, it can either be something that you do, but the time is what you use to produce the money. So you find people say, time is actually money. And every person who's wealthy, you will find that they value time. Time is very important. You find that for you to see them, you need to make an appointment. You find that they always have a wristwatch. They are always conscious of time. You find that they plan things. They don't do things anyhow. They don't just do things that drop in their mind. They just do things according to a pattern. They don't enter a day that they have not planned. They don't enter a week that they have not planned. They don't enter a month that they have not planned. If you can learn that, to say every person is responsible for their own time and that what they do with their time determines where they end up. Some people, because of abuse of time, they'll end up in a poor state. Some people, because of investing time. Let me push this on time so that you understand this. We all have 24 hours. No one has 26, no one has 23. Every human being has 24 hours. Let me show you what poor people do with their 24 hours. Most of it, they use it for sleeping. Second, they use it for watching TV. Third, they use it for pleasure. They want to visit, they want to go and spend time, they want to chat. Fourth, they use it for eating. Now, look at all those things. By the time somebody sleeps, by the time somebody watches TV, by the time somebody goes spending time visiting, by the time somebody spends time eating, they don't have any time left. Their whole 24 hours is gone. And this is a person who's saying, life is hard. But they find time to talk. They find time to play. They find time for entertainment. Have you seen that poor people love entertainment? They know the latest things. They know everything that is happening. They are very current. But look at the things that bring value. Things like skill, things like gifting, things like developing ability, things like bringing services or products, things like competence, things like being able to be excellent. The things that really affect their balance sheet, the things that affect their bank account, the things that affect their income at the end of the day, they are not knowledgeable of. They don't spend any of their time in them. The things that have got nothing to do with their life, they know everything about. You find a person knows everything about football, but the person is not a footballer. You find a person knows everything about politics, but the person is not a politician. You find a person knows everything about current affairs. They are so current when it comes to news, lifestyle, entertainment. They are so current, they don't miss anything. But let them show you how current their account is. Let them show you how their balance sheet is. They can't show you anything because they are current in things that do not apply. They are highly skilled in things that do not affect them at the end of the day. And this is the separation that separates the rich and the poor. They make choices, and with their choices, they choose to do something with their day. They choose to do something with their time. And this is, to me, a very important distinction. We're going to go for a short break, and when we come back, I'm going to now show you what the wealthy do with their time, the type of choices that wealthy people do. Because if we can make the right choices and do the right things with our time and with our day, we will change the end product and the result that we get. People get surprised that sinners sin. What do you think a sinner must do? Sinners sin. So you cannot take in a sinner and expect them not to sin. Tell somebody, sinners sin. Come on, tell somebody, the job of a sinner is to sin.
Worship you can give him is your surrender to him, your total surrender.
Barak Bible Training Center, a place of integrity and excellence. Enrollment is on. Registration fee 100 kwacha, non-refundable. Orientation currently in process. Classes morning and evening. Barak Bible Training Center is located at Goshen, opposite football house of Arikin Carter Road. Cell 0955-0965-0977-78-9975 or 0979-221392.
Welcome back, viewers. Before we went on the break, I was talking about the choices that people make that differentiate them. I said poor people make choices that make them poor in the way they go about their day, in the way they use their time. A lot of people do not understand that everything that you do is taking you somewhere. The result of where we are is proof that we've been doing some things that have brought us to where we are. And I said, poor people do not know the value of time. They do not know how to plan a day. They do not know how to have an agenda. A lot of people who are poor just waste their time. They waste their day. They waste their ability. They love to spend time having fun, going into entertainment. Actually, a lot of people who are poor are skilled in the wrong things. They've got a lot of knowledge about things that do not apply to your everyday life. They've got a lot of information about things that will not affect their financial life or their economic life. So a lot of people have become poor, and a lot will continue to become poor because they don't understand that life is a choice. You sitting right now listening and hearing what you're hearing, it's a choice. You'd have made a choice to go and do something else. So life is a choice. And everything that you do, it's a decision that you made. Say, I'll do this. Now, the same way people make choices that make them poor, the rich and the wealthy make choices as well. The rich and the wealthy make choices to be knowledgeable. One thing you know about people who are wealthy, they are knowledgeable not about everything, but they are knowledgeable about the thing that they are passionate about. They are knowledgeable about the thing that they want to spend the rest of their lives in. Rich and wealthy people are knowledgeable about the business that they want to go in. They are knowledgeable about the career that they want to take on. They are knowledgeable about the investment that they want to put their lives earning into. So you find that the difference between the poor and the rich is the choices that they make. And the choices that they make come up when it comes to the value. Things like time. Wealthy people value their time. Why? They know that time is a currency. They know that every day a person wakes up, they have 24 golden boxes. And in each box, which is every hour, they choose what to put in it. And every person has 24 hours. So they work with their 24 hours. They invest it. They study books in line with their gifting, in line with their business, in line with the product that they want to go into the service that they want to go into. Anything that interests them, that is going to affect their future, affect their economic life, their financial life, they will begin to make it a study. They go into research. They start learning. They start buying books. They start researching. I'll give you a practical example. A lot of people use Facebook. They use the internet, use WhatsApp, use Google to search. But what they are searching for, most of the time, has got nothing to do with what will affect them. They search, they use the internet, they use the web for a lot of things. Wealthy people use it to gain leverage. They use it as a tool, as an instrument to research, to find out what are the market trends, what is this product like, if I were to go in this direction, who has gone in this direction, who's doing what. So they use the same tools that an average or poor person uses. The average and the poor person uses them to have entertainment, to have fun, to communicate. A wealthy person uses them to study, to research, to network. It's the same tools that they are using. But you see, they've got difference in the way they value, difference in the lens that they use to see things. So it's very important that if you are going to become wealthy, you begin to see things from the point of view that wealthy people do. They have a different lens. They are conscious of time. They plan their day. They don't enter a day they have not planned. They don't enter a week they have not planned. They don't enter actually a month that they have not planned, a year that they have not planned. Their day has got priorities. And each priority is lined up in order of the importance of what that priority will bring. Meaning they've got a plan for the day. With a plan, they've got priorities. This comes first. This comes second, this comes third, in order of the returns that they will get from the first priority, second and third. And that's why they are successful, because the way they use their time, the way they use their energy, the way they use their resources, it's all focused. It's all driven to get a desired result. And you don't find a poor person planning a day. You can go to anyone who's poor and you take them to say, let's go for a ride. They will be happy to go for a ride. You tell them, say, let's go to another city. You tell them, let's go to Kafue, let's go to Kabwe. They enjoy the ride. It's so fun to them. They have no plan. They have no program for the day. But the person who's wealthy, every time they move, there's an assignment. There's a mission. There's a purpose. They do nothing outside purpose. Everything that they do, there must be something that they must get out of it at the end of the day. And you see, these are the different things that separate the poor and the rich. If you want to become wealthy, I would encourage you, begin to study what you do with the day. Begin to study what you do with time. Begin to see the way you plan something before you enter into it. Begin to see what type of research have you done before you launch out, before you start something. A lot of people think that, I've heard people say this, that business is hard. Why is business hard to a lot of people? It's a gray area. What do I mean? You've been on a career path maybe for years. Then you choose to go into business. You're not skilled in it. You've not been trained in it. Most of the time, you've done little research or little study into it. And why I'm using business as an example is, if you are going to become wealthy, somewhere down the line, you need to go into business. I've read the Bible over and over, and the wealthiest people in the Bible were into businesses. I can give you Abraham. Abraham was into rearing of animals. The man had different animals. He had cattle, he had sheep, he had goats, he had camels. He was into rearing of animals. And back in the days, the person who had camels and donkeys was in charge of the transportation system. So anytime you read in your Bible and you see a person has donkeys and camels, know that person is into transportation. Anytime you see a person has got a lot of cattle, don't just look at those as, oh, they've got a lot of cattle, they've got animals. No. That person is into the meat industry. That person is into the clothing industry. That person is, the skins from the animals are used to make tents. So when you hear that the person has got animals in the Old Testament, in the Bible, that person was industrious, because through those animals, they were into dairy products. They were into milk. Through those animals, they were into making of skins, clothes, even the things that they used for shields in battle. So a lot of things, a lot of people have not really gone into, were businesses. Every time you read in the Old Testament or in the Bible of people, like when you study a man like Job, you hear a man like Job had a lot of camels, a man like Job had a lot of donkeys, meaning he controlled the transport system in his area because that was the transportation mode of their time. So you find that you will never find a wealthy person, whether in the Bible, outside the Bible, who is not into services. Look at people today who are wealthy and have money. They either supply meat to Zambia. They are either in charge of transportations like flash buses. They are either in charge of shops like ShopRite. So everyone who has money, anyone who is anything, anyone who's wealthy, they are into services. They are into running of businesses. And if you are going to become wealthy, somewhere on the path, you will need to enter into business. You will need to enter into business. It's something that if you have just been on the career path, and when you hear something like this, don't just jump in and say, oh, I've heard something today that all wealthy people go into business, and you start thinking of maybe stopping your career to go into business. That's not how you do it. There is a law that we teach in the School of Wealth which says when you are starting, you keep your job but you mind your own business. That's what people like Solomon did. Solomon's job was to be king. You find that in 1 Kings chapter 3. He was the king. And him being king, that was his primary job, if you go and talk about a job description. And his job description was to govern people, governance. But guess what? That same man who had a job to be king, when you read Ecclesiastes chapter 2 from verse 4 coming down, it begins to show you the different businesses that Solomon had. So Solomon kept his job as king over Israel, but he minded his own business. When you read 1 Kings chapter 10, the whole chapter, 1 Kings chapter 10, you will see the depth of industry that that man had. Solomon was into the transportation industry. He had ships at sea. Solomon was into, you talk about consultancy. The Bible says the whole world sought audience. The whole world sought audience in 1 Kings chapter 10. The whole world sought audience to come and sit under the feet of Solomon to hear the wisdom that God had put in his heart. So every nation that wanted to have a powerful economy, because Solomon did something in his day that no other king had done. In the time of Solomon, he devalued. Imagine, he rose so much when it comes to wealth. Silver was as common as sand. I want you to think, comprehend that. Just digest that a little bit. Silver was as common as sand. Silver was looked at as of little value in the days of Solomon. He only used gold. And the man was so brilliant that silver, he used it to trade. But he kept his money in gold. And the whole world wanted to learn, how did this man come up with a system that raised the economy of his nation? And that's why the whole world came to see Solomon. They came to see and to hear. They came to experience the wisdom. They came to understand. Imagine, he developed a model that was so high that every other nation wanted to pattern around that model. He became a signpost. He became an example. He became the ultimate picture of achievement. You talk about a nation moving from third world to first world. Some of the things that Solomon did, I believe, even as a nation, Zambia, we need to go into it. How he encouraged entrepreneurship. Solomon encouraged entrepreneurship so much that in the time of Solomon, no one had a job. In the time of Solomon, every Israelite, the citizens of the nation, he made sure every one of them had their own farm and they were productive. The people that he gave jobs to were people who were slaves, people that had conquered, people that had captured. But his own people, he made sure every one of them had an industry. Every one of them had business. Every one of them was producing something. And he rose the economy short to become one of the best economies ever because the man pushed people to be productive. I do not surprise if this nation also begins to go that direction where everyone who end up owning a service, everyone who end up owning a company that provides services, everyone who end up being at a place where they start producing, everyone who end up running their own business, running their own company. And listen, to me, that is where we'll start really hitting wealth. When people learn how to be productive. Because if all of us can produce, I guarantee you, we can affect the economy of this nation. We are going to go for a short break. And when we come back, we are now going to go more into why we need to start changing our mindset from just being limited to being on a career to considering now to having a part-time business that you grow to become a full-time business. Stay tuned.